Well, it's been 5 years since the Uluru Convention in 2017, and you read the Uluru Statement in public for the first time. What was the atmosphere like in the room at the time?
There was a group elected from the convention who met in a room and started drafting that statement. The full statement is very easy to understand when you read all of the records of meetings of every single dialogue, because almost every single line is drawn from someone's voice in a dialogue, whether it's Broome, whether it's Dubbo. And we were really conscious of this. Even the Uluru Statement is just the first page, right? It's the logic to the Australian people. But following that is the legal kind of explanation of the legal reform. And then there's our story, our voice, our history. And we footnoted everything because it was really important to make sure that people in the regions knew that we were staying true to their voice. And that's an important thing about the convention that's not well understood. The convention wasn't for people to turn up and overturn what happened in the dialogues. The role of the convention was for each dialogue region to get up and read what had happened in the dialogue. That was it. One of the things that was first and foremost in our minds when we were designing it was, one, it needed to be underpinned by cultural authority. And I know people throw that around a lot, but when I grew up, you know, you knew who your community were. You knew who your elders were. It's those people who are the bedrock of our culture. So we wanted to make sure that the outcome at the end was really robust. And that's why 60% of the invitations that were sent out needed to be privileged for cultural authority, traditional owners, etc. The people in the room had to be the people that didn't have a voice. And the key thing about that then was we structured in a way to try and stop groupthink. We wanted people to be informed, and we wanted their thinking to be free.
Do you think this statement has the equivalent power and beauty of the great political speeches like Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream address? I have a dream
today. Uluru was the great kind of response to the Recognise campaign, which all of our people rejected. We don't want symbolism. You know, we want change, real change. So, yes, it is one of the great pieces of poetry, and we felt we needed to write something powerful to persuade the Australian people to support us like they did in 1967.
The referendum is on Saturday, and it's important that we should have the maximum vote.
It's a matter of democratic right.
Because politicians just won't. They won't without the Australian people pushing. And we know that because for 20, 30 years, our issues have just been off the agenda. And we're kind of hampered by this skewed reconciliation process that has ignored truth and justice since John Howard decided to detangle social justice and our aspirations from reconciliation. And reconciliation sided with John Howard. And Uluru was a correction, right? It was saying you can't have reconciliation unless you're talking about this, the original grievance, issues of sovereignty, issues of justice. And the key thing about the justice point, Karla, is justice is what does repair look like to our people? What does repair look like? And that's the challenge to the Australian people. Can, you know, we're saying voice and Makarrata is what repair looks like. Our voice enshrined in the Constitution and then a Makarrata commission from which cascades agreement-making and truth-telling. That is what we're saying repair looks like. And we needed to write something that helped them understand, and that's why it's so powerful. But it's powerful because it's our people talking together, their words, their sentences, and it's beautiful. You know, you get goosebumps anytime that you read it. And the first time I read it, it was extraordinary. We seek a Makarrata Commission to supervise a process of agreement making between governments and First Nations and truth telling about our history. In 1967, we were counted. In 2017, we seek to be heard. I remember my dear friend, Josie Douglas, just bawling, just crying. And, you know, because our people deserve this. We deserve structural reform. I mean, what if we miss this chance? One of the things the old people said in the dialogues was reconciliation is the wrong word, because reconciliation assumes that there was a prior friendship, but we have never met. That is what they said. We have never met. We weren't friends. There weren't friendly relations. There is no reconciling. This is what the Uluru Statement is. It's the beginning. We're asking Australians to meet us at the rock. We have some grievances to raise with them, and we want them to walk with us in this movement of the Australian people for a better future.